Buyers expect more and more of organizations and businesses, particularly when it comes to customized experiences. As Brianne can also tell you, as the buying experiences evolve and buyers' expectations grow, sales and sales processes need to keep up.
Yeah, so much of sellers' time is spent looking for information, making sure information is current, pulling together the right people and shooting out emails, amongst many other different things.
Exactly. I get questions all the time about like, okay, great, we've got this one piece of personalized content. Now, how do we scale that and make sure it gets to all the clients we need it to see?
Yeah, it's
a lot of questions.
Tons.
So other questions might be like, how can we keep our team and, in this case, our company, mm-hmm. from being left behind? Well, I think you've got an answer.
Yeah. Amanda, today AI agents are here to the rescue. They streamline the process of pulling client information together for faster analysis. They optimize sales workflows and they help efficiently create more personalized content.
Keep going.
Yeah. Sales teams can gain a lot from using AI, specifically AI assistants and AI agents.
Okay, so I'm glad you mentioned AI assistants and AI agents, because last year, all I heard about was generative AI.
Yeah.
Like figuring out an AI assistant.
Yep.
Where does AI agents come in? Help me walk through this.
Yeah, that's a great question. So generative AI is here to stay, and AI agents really builds on that concept. But let's go all the way back to first where we had virtual assistants, because that's where all of this starts. And you can think of virtual assistants as really fixed flow. They told us if this, then that, used things like intent recognition to guide a user throughout a conversation.
Okay.
Then we had the addition of Gen AI, and we had AI assistants. So that's smarter intent recognition with large language models. So being able to better route the user's intent, as well as being able to answer conversational questions that had never been answered before. So if I asked about something that the assistant didn't know, with the addition of Gen AI, right, we could use a large language model to synthesize an accurate response to something that wasn't part of that fixed flow.
Okay. All right. I got this. I'm with you.
All right. Now we are adding agentic framework to that AI assistant to get back to our AI agents. So building on all of the tools and technology we had from before and adding the ability to do. So outside of that, just conversational flow, the ability to actually take action and do things behind the scenes, that's what AI assistance plus agent framework allows us to do with AI agents.
Okay. All right. So I've got this. So we've got the conversational AI assistants. We've got more of the doing, the action AI agents. How do I know which one to pick for a particular use case? What do I have to think about to know what to use?
Great question. So AI assistants are really best for these very, very specific tasks, which can be achieved via conversation. So think of your chatbots, right? Answering questions where you need that interactive conversational experience. So maybe it's a chatbot where you need information about a product, which might use a RAG approach where you go out and get the information and synthesize it back. So it could be pulling the latest details on capabilities, roadmap items, something where you really want to ask follow-up questions, right? Or you're part of this still sometimes a fixed flow where you know exactly the response you're going to get. Now, building on that, AI agents are really perfect for tasks that require more complex decision-making and adaptation. So these agents truly have agency. They perform an actual action for you and they do the work. So instead of a chat where you might ask questions about a product or ask questions about pulling information about who a user is to generate an email, the agent will actually go out and do that for you. So it's going to pick up the profile from LinkedIn and then use that profile to personalize an outreach email.
Based on what I'm hearing, I think, Brianne, we need an AI agent.
Okay.
So.
Yep.
All right. So it's going to help me with prospecting.
Yep.
And, you know, as you know, as you said earlier, like, that takes up so much time, right?
Yeah.
Prospecting takes tons of time and has a painfully low ROI.
Oh, yeah.
Because of it. So let's walk through, like, talk me through how do I actually set up an AI agent to do this? Like, what do I need to think about? What's going to happen in the background? You know, just step by step.
Yeah. All right. So step one, let's start by talking about what your use case is.
Okay.
And what would define a successful outcome for that use case?
Okay. So use case is, you know, I want it to be a prospecting agent. Mm-hmm. It's going to help me gather current information about prospective clients or whoever I'm wanting to reach out to, those marketing contacts. It's also going to give me information about, you know, the products and things like that. And basically then have a mechanism for being able to create responses, create content, you know, like an email, say. And so then if the user interacts with that email, clicks something like that, that's the success.
Right? Awesome. A response or knowing that they viewed a video or information you sent from your email.
Exactly.
Perfect. That's great. So now that we've defined our use case and our goals, let's design the workflow of the agent.
Okay.
The agent workflow here. So how would you like to achieve that?
Okay. So first, obviously, again, we need the contact information, right? So we're looking at, you know, their role, their email, their interests and needs. And I would say that you need the same information from the product side as well, right? To understand that. So part of this information is coming, it's coming from all different systems, right? But then, so essentially then I want to be able to aggregate it,
right?
And highlight and see a synthesis where there are opportunities.
Awesome.
And create content that's engaging the prospect based on those unique opportunities.
Perfect. So we have kind of a basic workflow end to end. How do you want this information to be consumed? Do you want this to be a chat interface, or do you just want it to generate an email?
So, I mean, I want some of the stuff to happen in the background.
Yeah.
Obviously, kind of pick up the time. But I think a chat interface as well, because I want to be able to check things and verify. So I want to be able to see like what's generated before it goes out to the clients.
Yeah. So that's a great place to start, because we want to verify and make sure information is correct. And then we can give feedback to the model too and ask additional questions before you're comfortable with maybe something going on in the background without you viewing it or really automating the full end-to-end process. Exactly. So some common other types of agents and agents that we might want to consider here are something like a single agent. And a single agent handles all aspects of an interaction, right? So everything under a specific category or task would be handled by the one agent. Now, we also have something called multi-agent, and that's when separate agents handle different tasks. These agents might work together. So you might have, you know, more than just a prospecting agent, something that's a sales agent that not just does prospecting, but answers questions on deals or product questions for an RFP.
Oh, nice.
And it could pull together different single agents from your agent that just does prospecting.
Okay.
We also have a concept of something called a headless agent. So a headless agent is something that is designed to operate autonomously in the background with absolutely no UI. So this could be used if you want email generation, right? So something to shoot out an email in the background, but you don't need that conversational UI or chat experience. So data collection and prospecting, alerting, that's a really common use case. What if you're in sales and you want an alert when a ticket goes out? You don't need a chat to interact with that, but you're going to have a headless agent actually send that notification. Very cool.
Yeah.
Let's start by creating a single agent using chat. So we only need one agent since your agent has a very single specific goal.
Okay.
Since you want to interact with the agent, we're going to make this an agent chat. You want to give feedback, really make sure the agent's responding appropriately. And if you wanted to review the email or if you didn't want to review the email or provide any feedback, then we could actually make this a headless agent. So we could have that email sent out in the background and automated. And you would just maybe get a record of when it went out to your client. You wouldn't need to do anything at all.
Nice. So even if I make it a single agent right now, I can make it a headless agent later.
Yeah.
And just remove that piece. Nice.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. So all these things can be changed. Also, if you wanted to turn this into a multi-agent use case, you could build on this single agent and add additional agents to address additional use cases. So let's talk about the next piece, which is data integration.
All right.
Now, where would you want the information to come from for your agent?
Sure. So, you know, I have a CRM, obviously. So we want to get information from the CRM. That's going to have a lot of client information. There's also probably going to be some coming from the web.
Yeah.
Right.
On
products and on trends and industry needs. So I think, probably, you know, we're going to need both of those. So are there integrations that already exist with CRMs or is...
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, great question. And that actually moves us into our next section, which is frameworks. So using the data integrations that you've already specified, you might have integrations that you can take advantage of. There's many tools out there that actually have reusable integrations that others have used and built from that gives you that starting board to more quickly build a single use case. And there's a number of frameworks that are available for no code or low code options. So is this your first time building an agent?
Building an agent, yes.
Definitely don't have enough coding experience with that one.
Awesome. Well, that's the great thing is you can use these number of low code frameworks to really help you get started.
And you also want to think about storage, right? So how are you storing this information, your memory and data? And you want to think about what knowledge, like that CRM and web and more, are actually going to empower your agent. Now that we've defined your framework, you're ready to get started and you're ready to start building.
Is there a particular LLM? So I remember the previous chart, right? So I need to think about the model. Yeah. So is there a particular one that's best for this?
Yeah. Great question, because there's so many different LLMs out there for you to choose from. It depends, which I know is always the best
part answer.
The best answer. It really depends on your use case, but I'd recommend starting with something that's very cost efficient, right? So start with the cost efficient models like Mistral or a Llama.
Okay.
And if you aren't seeing, the performance you desire from those models, you can actually switch to other different types of models and kind of experiment and find what works best for you. But in many cases, engineers really will start with some of the larger models, which will certainly give you, the most general responses for a variety of questions, but can really result in higher costs, especially if in these agent interactions, they're being used a number of times. So finally, something that's really important that we don't want to use or leave out, we want to make sure you're using and defining guardrails. So you want to think about what guardrails and processes you really want to add around the agent to ensure it's acting as you'd expect. So in this case, you did want to use a chat to make sure that you're reviewing that email before it's going out to the client, maybe asking additional questions and providing feedback. And that's really what these guardrails are for, to make sure that the condition that you set is in place before
it goes out
to the client.
To make sure that
that agent is acting as you'd expect. So to start, you do want to review the emails before they go out.
Definitely want to review the emails. Maybe someday it becomes automated.
Yeah.
I think any you know, any information before it goes out to the client right now, I would want to review and also even have like checks, yeah. you know, to make sure it's in line with our brand. And
perfect. So, yeah. Perfect. And that's a great place to start.
I just want to make sure I've got the business yeah. side, the business use case.
Yeah, yeah.
So before I go and be like, I want to spend my time doing this.
Yes.
Yep. Business use case is that once built, this prospecting agent is going to be able to obviously, like, you know, through this workflow, speed up
yeah.
the prospecting time,
mm-hmm.
right? Hopefully yep. get even better informed yeah. and more teed up clients,
yep.
you know, be a bit more on the mark. And eventually, we're hoping that that would lead to moving towards a positive ROI when
yeah.
it comes to prospecting, not yeah. such a low one.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's right?
Yeah. yeah definitely. Okay. Definitely. So as agents become more and more powerful and common, and the space is getting pretty crowded. I mean, you can Google AI agents and you can find a number of tools, frameworks, suggestions, and it's the latest buzzword. It can be hard to tell what really works or what is just hype in the market. And that's why it's more important than ever to build with intention, right? Mm. Really making sure that you're picking the use case that's right for agentic framework and keeping in mind reusability, right? So how could this agent be reused? And we don't really need to reinvent the wheel with every new tool or every new product, but we should really focus on creating agents that are adaptable, dependable, and easy to build on. Because that's how real progress scales.
I love that. That is so good. Adaptable, dependable.
Yep.
And what was the last one again?
Scalable.
Love it. Thanks, Brianne.
Thanks.